Hello friends, myself Professor Prashant Mahajan, working as an assistant professor at AISSMS Institute of Information Technology. So today we are going to see a lecture on fuels. We are going to see definition of fuel, classification of fuel, and characteristic of a ideal fuel. So what is fuel? So fuel is a substance which is containing carbon as a major constituent and which on proper burning produces large amount of heat, and that heat can be utilized for domestic as well as industrial purposes. So you can see the definition. So this is the definition of a fuel. So a chemical fuel is defined as a combustible substance containing carbon as major constituent which on proper burning gives large amount of heat, which can be used economically for domestic and industrial purpose. So development of nation depends on energy sources. So the energy can be created by using fuels like coals, petroleum, natural gas. So coal, petroleum, natural gas, petrol, diesel, kerosene, naphtha, coal gas, biogas, that are the some examples of fuels. But that can be classified into two types, that is classification based on the physical state. So first classification is some fuels are occurring naturally and some are derived fuels. So naturally occurring fuels are further classified into solid, liquid and gaseous fuel. So naturally occurring solid fuels are wood, peat, lignite, bituminous and cow dung. So that are the solid fuels. Similarly, naturally occurring liquid fuels are vegetable oil and crude oil. So crude oil, it is also called as petroleum. And last, naturally occurring gaseous fuels are natural gas. So you can see here, this is classified into two types, primary or natural, which is further classified into solid, liquid and gaseous. Similarly, secondary fuel, it is also classified into solid, liquid and gaseous. So secondary solid fuel is coke and charcoal. Secondary liquid fuel is tar, kerosene, diesel, petrol, synthetic gasoline. And gaseous fuels are coal gas, water gas, biogas, producer gas and LPG. So this is the classification based on the physical state. There is one more classification which is based on the type of chemical reactions. So there are three types of reaction. One is combustion reaction, second is spontaneous oxidation reduction reaction, and third is nuclear reaction. So first, combustion. So there are two types, that is oxidation in the presence of air, that is burning of wood. And second, oxidation in the absence of air, that is in the rocket. So that is two types of combustion. That is, one is in the presence of air, that is burning of wood. And second is in the absence of air, that is in the rocket. So this is first type, combustion. Second, spontaneous oxidation and reduction. So that is, which is present in the fuel cells. So that is second type. And third is nuclear reactions, that is fission of uranium 233, and second is fusion of hydrogen atoms. So that is classification based on the chemical reaction. Then, so characteristics, next point is characteristic of ideal fuel or good fuel. So means what? If a fuel is to be a good fuel, then what characteristic should it possess? So first characteristic is high calorific value. That is, what is calorific value? Calorific value means the amount of heat liberated on complete combustion of 1 gram of a substance. Means what? If a substance is giving large amount of heat, that means it has high calorific value. So you can see, as the amount of heat liberated and the temperature attained depends upon the calorific value of the fuel. So a good fuel should possess high calorific value. So this is first point, a good fuel should have high calorific value. Means what? A fuel should generate large amount of heat. Second, moderate ignition point. So what is ignition point? It is the minimum temperature at which fuel catches fire. So why it should be moderate? You can see, if the ignition temperature is low, then there is a chances of fire hazards during storage and transportation. Means what? Consider the example of hydrogen. If we store hydrogen at room temperature, its boiling point is minus 253 degrees Celsius. So at room temperature, it will get ignited. So there is a chances of fire hazards. So if it is low, then there is a chances of fire hazards during storage and transportation. And where as if the ignition temperature is high, it is, although it is safe for storage and transportation, gives difficulty in ignition and burning of fuel. Hence, it should be moderate. So you can see here, if the ignition temperature is high, although it is safe for storage and transportation, it gives difficulty in ignition and burning. For example, you can consider wood. If you want to burn wood or ignite wood, it will take more time as compared to liquid or gaseous fuel. So there are two problems. One, if the ignition point is low, then there is a chances of fire hazards. And if it is high, then there is a difficulty in ignition and burning of fuel. So ignition point should be moderate. Third point, moderate velocity of combustion. So you can see, if the velocity of combustion is low, if the velocity of combustion is low, then required temperature will not be attained quickly. So that is one problem. If the velocity of combustion is high, then liberated heat cannot be utilized properly. Therefore, it should be moderate. So you can see here, if it is low, then required temperature will not be attained quickly. And if it is high, then liberated heat cannot be utilized properly. Therefore, velocity of combustion should be moderate. So that is third point. Fourth point, low moisture content. So that you know very well, if a fuel contains moisture, then it will produce smoke. So moisture content in the fuel decreases calorific value of fuel, as during combustion, part of heat liberated is utilized in evaporation of moisture and formation of steam. So it will add to the cost of the fuel and it will increase the weight of the fuel. So a good fuel should have, or a good fuel should contain moisture in the low quantity, because of it will increase the cost of the fuel, it will increase the weight of the fuel, it will cause pollution, and heat it is utilized for evaporation of moisture and formation of steam. So a good fuel should have low moisture content. Fifth point, low ash content. So what is ash? Ash, it is the product formed after combustion of non-combustible matter present in the coal sample. So non-combustible matter present in a coal is converted to ash. That means, if more the non-combustible matter, more will be the ash. If non-combustible matter is more, then combustible matter will be less, and that will reduce the calorific value. Okay, so combustible matter is high, then calorific value will be high. So ash forms clinkers, blocking air circulation and hindering complete burning of fuel. This further reduces heat output of fuel. So ash contributes additional cost for storage, handling and disposal. So what happens? If the non-combustible matter present in the coal sample is more, that will increase weight of the fuel, that will add to the cost, and that will be additional cost for storage, handling and disposal. If ash is formed, that will create pollution and that will be the disposal problem. Sixth point, product of combustion should not be harmful. So that you know very well, after burning of fuel, the products formed should not be harmful because it will cause pollution and it will be harmful to the human health. So you can see fuel on burning should not give out objectionable harmful gases like carbon monoxide, sulfur dioxide, hydrogen sulfide, etc., which may be harmful to health or cause pollution. So there are both chances that will be harmful to human health as well as it will create atmospheric pollution. So that is sixth point. Next, low cost. So fuel should be readily available at cheap rate. So you can avail that fuels at low rate. So that is 7 point, low cost. 8, easy storage and transportation. So a good fuel must be easy to store and transport at low cost. And last point, combustion rate should be easily controllable. So combustion of good fuel should be easy to start up and stop whenever required. So that is the last point, combustion rate should be easily controllable. So that means you can stop and you can start whenever required. So that are the 9 points or 9 characteristics for an ideal fuel. So first, high calorific value. Second, moderate ignition temperature. Third, moderate velocity of combustion. Fourth, low moisture content. Fifth, low ash content. Sixth, product should not be harmful. Seventh, fuel should be available at low cost. Eighth, easy storage and transportation. And ninth, combustion rate should be easily controllable. So this is a chart from you can identify a good fuel. So first column is of serial number, second is of criteria, that is characteristics, and third is solid, fourth is liquid, and fifth is gaseous fuel. So that table you can see, for example, moisture. So moisture of solid fuel, that is coal or wood, is higher than liquid fuel, nil, and gaseous fuel is nil. You can also see here ignition point, very high, moderate and very low. That is as we see in the part, that is a good fuel should have moderate ignition point. Then next is calorific value and its units. So what is calorific value? The calorific value is defined as the amount of heat liberated when a unit mass of fuel is burned completely in presence of air or oxygen. So this is a calorific value. Then units of calorific value. So if solid fuel is there and liquid fuel is there, then the units are, so you can see in the table, system is given, CGS system, MK system, SI system and British system. So for units of calorific value of solid and liquid fuels, we are weighing the fuels in gram or kilogram. So in CGS system, the unit is calorie per gram. when you are going to see gaseous fuel, that gram it is going to convert into meter cube. So for CGS system, the unit is calorie per gram. For MK system, the unit is kilocalorie per kilogram. For SI system, the unit is joule per kilogram. And for British system, the unit is British thermal unit by pound. So that are the four units of calorific value of solid and non-volatile liquid fuels. The interconversion for or of calorific value unit is, so you can see here, just a minute, 1 kilocalorie per gram is, 1 calorie per gram is equal to 1 kilocalorie upon 1 kilogram. So here is kilo, here is kilo, both are same, you can cancel this kilo and this kilo, is equal to 1.8 British thermal unit upon pound, which is equal to 4.187 kilojoule per kilogram. You can write here, this kilo can be cancelled with this kilo, so that is joule per gram. So if solid fuel is there, you have to divide that calorie by gram, here gram, here gram. So that is units of calorific value for solid fuel. Next, for gaseous fuel, as gaseous fuels are measured in terms of their volume, and the volume it is measured in the form of liter or meter cube. So for CGS system, the unit is calorie per liter. As we are measuring gas in the terms of their volume, so that is calorie per liter. In the MK system, kilocalorie per meter cube. In SI system, joule per meter cube. And in the British system, British thermal unit per cubic feet. So that are the units of gaseous fuel. You can see the difference clearly here. Here is gram, kilogram, kilogram, and here is pound. But in the case of gaseous fuel, that gram is converted into liter, kilogram is converted into meter cube, kilogram is converted into meter cube, and pound is converted into cubic feet. So that is the only difference between two units. The interconversion of calorific value unit is 1 kilocalorie per meter cube is equal to 0.1077 British thermal unit per cubic feet, which is equal to 4.187 kilojoule per meter cube. Then, okay, that's it for today's lecture. Thank you.